Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's session on BIC Streams. This is part of a month-long series of children's programs that we have planned for all of you on all weekends of November. Today's session is Life in Our Cities, an introduction to the biodiversity of our city. So this talk is going to be all about trees, plants, water bodies, birds, monkeys, bees, butterflies, everything that you see around us. And joining us to help us know more about our urban biodiversity is Ullas Anand, who is the co-founder of EcoEdu. Thank you so much for doing this for us, Ullas, and joining us on this Saturday morning. Of course, you can ask Ullas questions at the end of the session. We'll bring you on screen to ask you the Ullas questions directly. If you want to know more about such programs, do sign in to our mailing list. And welcome everyone again. And with that, over to you, Ullas.
Thanks, Raghu. Am I coming through yes. Loud? Okay, cool. So, hi everyone. Good morning. So today we're going to mainly focus on life in our cities with a very specific focus on Bangalore and what we can get to see in Bangalore. When we say life, this is about all the birds and the plants and other life forms that surround us versus, you know, the human life, you know, which we are all very familiar with. So we're going to look at, you know, what somebody who's at home, especially during these difficult times, can see, you know, probably from their balconies, from their terraces, in their gardens. And we're going to focus around, you know, common life forms that one can see here. And some of it might be a little, you know, far from your homes right now, but then they're very much part of Bangalore and Bangalore's, you know, wildlife, you know, landscape. So let me just start with, you know, the presentation. Do feel free to ask questions. So when we talk about, you know, nature and wildlife, what comes to mind are these rolling vistas of hills and greenery and, you know, beautiful close canopy, you know, forests. We imagine beautiful creatures like this elephant or the spotted deer, or you know, the gaur, which is the Indian, you know, the Indian most common Indian, you know, wild buffalo that we have. Then you also have, you know, you think about the leopard, the tiger. And when we talk about cities, we talk about, I mean, what comes to mind is construction, right? And what comes to mind is traffic and chaos and small spaces where people live, and, you know, high-rise buildings which are, you know, different, which support different forms of cranes rather than the birds. And, you know, we get to imagine apartments. And when we talk about, you know, do you know any bird that you see around your house? The first thing that comes to mind is a pigeon, right? I mean, these are things that are all around us. So let's try and see what else is there, which is, you know, which is visible, you know, in our cities. So when we say wildlife, what is wildlife? Wildlife is any undomesticated organism. So it can be anything which is not kept as a pet or kept to work for us, like bullocks or, you know, cattle or any of those things. And this includes, yeah, plants, animals, and of course, you know, the cockroach, the mosquito, everything is wildlife because we don't keep them and we do support them in some way. But they are wild, you know, life, technically, and they're found all around us, right? So when we talk about our country, India is one of those very unique, you know, countries which belong to the super club, as we call it, of 13 or 14 countries which support maximum number of life forms across on this globe, right? And one of the reasons why India has such a huge, you know, representation of life forms is because we have everything. We have a desert. We've got rolling, you know, hills. of the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats. We have very vast, you know, sea coastline. We also have the world's largest delta, which is the Sundarbans, where the Ganga and the Brahmaputra, you know, empty out into the Bay of Bengal. We also have our rivers, which also support, you know, a lot of the plains where, you know, a whole lot of forests and, you know, deciduous trees can be found. Then we also have the Trans-Himalayan Belt, which is where the Indian shelf has hit the Asian continental shelf, giving rise to the youngest mountains in the world, which are the Himalayas. And these mountains, again, have a lot of forms of life, both below and above the snow line. And, you know, we have pretty much every kind of habitat imaginable, you know, in our country. And when we talk about habitats, we talk about adaptations. And when we talk about adaptations, we talk about life forms which have evolved to make use of those habitats and their specific adaptations to live a life there. So we get a very vast variety of life in our country. We also have island ecosystems in Andamans and Lakshadweep, which also have corals and which also give rise to, you know, a whole lot of life forms, you know, in the ocean. And we also have an ocean named after our country, which is the Indian Ocean, which is down south. So we have seas, oceans, rivers, deserts, hills, mountains, you know, everything, right? And it's a very big country. When we talk about Bangalore, Bangalore is located right in between the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats. So the last finger of Western Ghats, so this is the last finger where my mouse is right now. This is Vanagata, which has got a Bangalore pin code right now. You know, it is within the city or part of the extended part of the city. And it's as the crow flies from, say, Vidhana Sauda, it is about 20 kilometers, right? 21 kilometers. And it's a national park. And if one gets into Vanagata today, they can go into the forest. What we are familiar with Vanagata is the zoo part of it. But then behind the zoo, there's a big forest. And if one gets into that forest without ever coming out of the forest today, one can go all the way to Biar Hills or to, you know, Bandipur and Nagarhole without ever coming out of the forest. So it's one of those last fingers of Western Ghats which touches Bangalore. And on the Eastern Ghats side, we have the closest Eastern Ghats is towards, you know, Krishnagiri and Hosur, which is again very close to Bangalore and Electronic City. And that literally again touches, you know, Bangalore. So Bangalore is kind of a conduit between these two. And geographically also, Bangalore is located on one of the oldest pieces of rock on this planet. So the first rocks that formed when the Earth started cooling down is found on, you know, in the Deccan Plateau, and Bangalore is located on that, you know, on those rocks, which are what we call as the peninsular knees. And they're about anywhere between, you know, 3.5 to 2.3 billion years old. And when we look at the Bangalore, today, when we look at the city today, what we see is that, you know, the old city has grown further and further. And today we have the greater Bangalore area, as we call it, which includes, you know, Electronic City, which includes Whitefield, which includes, you know, a whole lot of places which were never, you know, traditionally Bangalore as such. And then, you know, you have much larger, you know, growth and urban sprawl, which is spreading across. And some of the places, like I was mentioning, the National Park of Vanagata, or, you know, some of the other places around. So this is the new ring road, which is planned. So if you look at some of these things, they are literally, you know, outside what used to be traditional Bangalore, but also cover now, you know, a lot of regions which are now Bangalore, right? So this includes Ramnagaram and a whole lot of other places. Traditionally, Bangalore's vegetation has been thorn scrub. Thorn scrub means thorny bushes, you know, sprinkled across with, you know, smaller shrubs and a few trees here and there. And most of them are spread across these old rocks, which I already mentioned. So they kind of, I mean, the vegetation of Bangalore looked like this in some places. And in some places, it was just plain grasslands. And you can see still remnants of these grasslands if you go towards Hesargatta, Nandi Hills, even towards Bidadi and Kengeri. You'll still see a lot of these grasslands. And grasslands are very transient, you know, ecotypes, because, you know, if there's a lot of rain, a grassland becomes a scrub forest. If there's not much of rain, it becomes a desert. And in Bangalore, what has happened is because of, you know, a repeated tree planting and, you know, a whole lot of things that we have brought in, which was not traditionally, you know, the ecosystem that was found here, we do have, you know, a lot of changing habitat as such right now. Some of the, other things that one can find here are, you know, rocky hills. Rocky hills are very much these knobbly hills, which are part of Bangalore, and a lot of them have been converted into urban development. Today, there are houses on top of these hillocks. So they may not be very, prominent today, but if anybody remembers the old Bangalore, or drawings of the old Bangalore that the British have represented, there were a lot of these interspersed rocky hills around the city as well. And some of the other things are the wetlands, because Bangalore is located where there's no water source as such. So people stored water, built these tanks, large water tanks, which we call lakes today, but they're all water tanks meant for storing water for irrigation and for consumption. And these were built, we had a lot of them. In fact, when we went out, the bird watching community in Bangalore went out and did a survey at the beginning of this year, before the pandemic hit. We visited personally, I think, about 182 lakes as a group, and they still survive in some form around the city. And there could be many more if you extend the perimeter of what we were looking at as a distance cover. We still do have close to 200 lakes around the city, which still are active and hold water. And these wetlands also support a lot of life. Talking about life and life forms in the city, some of the life forms that one can see if they are lucky. This is the largest moth in the world. This is the Atlas moth. It's a little bigger than my head. If it's sitting here, the wingspan would cover my head. This is found in Bangalore. The closest place I have seen this within the city is probably in Lal Bagh, that was a few decades ago. But you do get them still on the outskirts of the city. And these are very large, very beautiful moths that we have in the city. These dragonflies, these are called globe skimmers. You would have seen them over the last 3-4 weeks around the city. Stalling in midair, thousands upon thousands of them. They were all getting ready to migrate back to Africa. So they come from Africa to India and then spend 3 generations here, and the 4th generation goes back to Africa, and they spend 3 generations in Africa and they come back. And they catch the monsoon winds to do this transit, and they fly over the seas, the open seas. And you would have seen these dragonflies stalling in midair, you know, getting ready for their flight back to Africa. And I don't see them today. I mean, so they must have left or moved out of at least my locality here in Bangalore. But they were pretty common right outside my window, and they were in thousands upon thousands, they were all around, right? And these dragonflies, like I said, are the longest migrating insects in the world. And they can be found in Bangalore during the monsoon months. And then specifically at the start of the monsoon when they come in, and at the end of the monsoon when they go out. So the winds carry them back and forth from Africa. We also have the fastest bird in the world, which is found in Bangalore. The fastest bird in the world is the peregrine falcon. We get two races, or the two, the subspecies of peregrine falcon. One which is the migrating one, which comes all the way from Europe and the northern parts of Asia, which is the nominate peregrine falcon, which is the fastest bird, which has been clocked as the fastest bird. Then we also get another subspecies of this called as the Shaheen falcon, which actually nests in Bangalore. It's been found in tall buildings in Bangalore, like L&T South City, people have seen it in prestige Shantiniketan, you know, so they're found all around the city. And these birds are faster than a Formula One car. They fly at around 400 kilometers per hour when they dive, and they can reach gravitational, you know, acceleration forces of 25 G, and can pull out of a dive at that speed, at that acceleration. They can pull out of the dive, and they have very specific adaptations to do that. But they are the fastest birds in the world. And if one keeps an eye out, especially during the winter months, which is just now, you can actually see the white, nominate species of the peregrine falcon, which is the migratory one. And you can see the rufous one, which is the Shaheen falcon as well. If you, live in a tall high rise, or if you go to Nandi Hills, you'll be able to see the Shaheen falcon, which is pretty much prominent and, stays on one of the towers in Nandi Hills. Then we also get the one of the highest flying migrants in the world, which is the bar-headed geese. This is probably the fifth or the fourth highest flying bird in the world, but it is the highest flying migrant. These fly over the Himalayas, come from Tibet and Mongolia, and go all the way down to Sri Lanka, but then they do spend some time in the water bodies of Bangalore. And they used to be very common and found, during the winter months in large water bodies like Madurai, Kerala, and Hesargatta, various other places. Nowadays, they're much more difficult to be seen, but they are still around. You can still get them. We've still seen them over the last few water bird censuses. And these birds, people have seen them while climbing Mount Everest, fly overhead, right? And so these birds, again, have special adaptations to fly at that height. And they can do so, at very remarkable speeds. Like, for example, on the return migration, they've been known to fly from somewhere around Mumbai or the middle of India and reach the height of the mountains of the Himalayas within a few hours, which is like around 23,000 feet. And they're supposed to do a nonstop journey on their way back. Remarkable flyers again. We also have the largest bovine. It's not the American bison, but the Indian gaur. This weighs about a ton and a half. It stands around 6.5 to 7 feet tall. This is the male gaur. It's full of muscle, but then the gaur is a very large animal and one of the largest cattle in the world, the largest bovine, right? And found in Banagatta, there are big herds which have been recorded and photographed and videographed in Banagatta. As the crow flies from where I am sitting right now, Banagatta is less than 8 kilometers. So, you can still get to see these beautiful animals if one goes out. We also get the largest butterfly in India. This has also been declared as the state butterfly of Karnataka. This is called as the common birdwing. The birdwing is a butterfly which is very rare, not often seen in the urban areas, but we have seen this butterfly in Gandhi Bazaar, DVG Road, in Lal Bagh. We've seen this all over the city. And these butterflies are a little bigger than 18 centimeters. They're around 18 centimeters, so a little bigger than the half foot ruler, about 3 centimeters bigger than the half foot ruler, wingtip to wingtip. And very large butterflies, beautiful to look at. So they are found in Bangalore as well. We also get the smallest butterfly in India, which is the southern grass jewel, which is about 11 mm or about 1.1 centimeter, about the size of my nail on my little finger. And, they're again found amongst the grass. If one goes out, anywhere in any garden, you should be able to see them. The largest spider in India, in fact, I saw this during the, lockdown time in Lal Bagh. In one of the tree hollows. It's about the size of my palm, a little bigger. And it lives in hollows of trees and comes out and hunts. It doesn't build a web as such. And they hunt and they even take small birds down. This is the arboreal tarantula, and this is the largest spider that we have, one of the largest at least in India. The tarantulas as a group are the largest. And we find that in Bangalore. It's been rescued from an apartment in South Bangalore on the 14th floor. It's been rescued from the Visveshwaraya Industrial Museum building within Kabban Park, as well. I'm talking over the last 1 year. There are multiple rescues of this animal from on top of buildings now, because trees have given way to buildings. So they're finding hollows in buildings now to stay and breed. Also, the largest frog in India, the Indian bullfrog, is also found in Bangalore. Not very common anymore. It's been quite rare since some time. But it's about the size of a small kitten, a baby kitten, almost, about that big. And I have seen these around Bangalore while growing up. Now you need to go to the outskirts to actually see this. This is the male. During the breeding season, it gets a brilliant yellow color. And it also has these blue, bright blue opal sacs, which they use to attract mates. These frogs no longer are found within the city, at least, but they can still be seen outside. The closest place I've seen is on Tumkur Road to Bangalore. This was last year. The smallest snake in India, the blind snake. This is a group of snakes called as the blind snakes. If you dig up any pot in your garden, you should be able to see this. We normally mistake this for an earthworm. There are earthworms also, but you do have blind snakes as well. Blind snakes have scales on their body, and you can see the tongue come out once in a while, like other snakes. And these snakes are very small, very tiny. You can keep them on your hand, non-venomous, and they're all around. These are again, animals that you can see right within our garden. Also, the smallest bird, one of the smallest birds in India, the group as the flower pickers as a group are the smallest birds we have in India. This is the pale-billed flower picker. You would be able to see this if you have a Singapore cherry tree, which is called Gasca semara in Kannada. You'd be able to see this bird on that tree. They would be actively foraging for berries, and they can swallow pretty large berries. And these are very common birds. They're about the size of my thumb, very active feeders. And you should be able to see them on any fruiting tree. Mainly Singapore cherry is I can assure you that you will see this bird if you have a Singapore cherry tree in Bangalore. We also get the smallest bat in India, which is about the size of a butterfly, a large butterfly. You can see them during the evening times, below the lights, street lights, trying to hunt. These are insect-eating bats, so they have echolocation, so you can even get to hear them while they fly around. And you can see them pretty common outside any street light in Bangalore. You should be able to see the pipistrelle, about the size of a large butterfly, like I said, and very, very tiny. The largest bat in India, again, is the Indian flying fox. And there are colonies in Bangalore which support thousands of these animals. And these animals are fruit-eating bats, so they don't have echolocation, but they have extremely good eyesight, and they can smell very well. They're called flying foxes because of the way their head resembles that of a fox. And you would see thousands of these animals, flying out during the evenings, trying to find orchards where they can eat fruit. There's a big colony within Kabban Park. So if you're standing outside on MG Road, you'll see a lot of these bats flying overhead. They're about the size of the kite, which we normally call as the eagle. So they're about that size, that big. And you can see thousands upon thousands of these flying out. We also have a colony in South Bangalore near the Bugle Rock Park. We also have one more colony within the Nehru Planetarium in Kabban Park. So you have multiple colonies of these in Bangalore, and they're very active during the day as well, around the trees where they roost. And these are the largest bats in India. the subspecies of this in Thailand is the largest in the world, which is a little larger than this, but it's the largest bat in the world. We also have the largest land animal in India, which is the Asiatic elephant. If you go to Banagatta, you get very big herds of this. You get herds of up to 80 to 100 animals in a herd. And these move across the entire, the migration route, because they consume a lot of food. In a day, they take in, I think, close to about 200 kgs of food and about 100 liters of water. And if they're in one place, they'll decimate the forest. So they need to keep moving, and they move from place to place over a period of time, and they forage and they eat as they move. And by the time they've reached the end of their migration route, the forest that they've already consumed could have, you know, come back to life, and they, come back. So that's a cycle that used to happen. A lot of the places, the migration journey is broken by human habitation today, which leads to a lot of confrontation with these animals. But then these animals are pretty much part of Bangalore's, ecosystem. And they're found, like I said, you know, right across in Banagatta. They've even landed, I think, 5 to 8 years ago, within, they came into JP Nagar as well. And they were found in a lake in JP Nagar, having a bath, and, about 20 elephants. So they're very, very much a part of the, landscape here. We also get the national bird, the national animal, the national tree, and the national flower. All can be found in Bangalore. The tiger is found in the wild, not within the zoo safari in Banagatta, but in the wild. There's a small population of tigers which are now coming to Banagatta. So you do get tigers in Banagatta. They've been recorded on video. We get peacocks now. There are peacocks within Lal Bagh now. There are peacocks in Malleshwaram. There are peacocks in JP Nagar, which are found on top of homes in JP Nagar. So they have become a little more common within the city. We also have the big banyan tree on Mysore Road, which is, banyan is our national tree. So we do have multiple banyan trees. In fact, the roads, all highways around Bangalore were dotted with banyan trees once upon a time. When I was growing up, I remember, you know, seeing a lot of these highways with boulevards with, these trees around them. It's very rare now, but you do get to see them. Then you also have the national flower, which is the lotus, which grows in most of our lakes. Fauna of Bangalore, some of this data is has changed. It's dated. It comes from a 1999 survey by Karthikeyan. And I've taken the birds from the eBird, but all these numbers have gone up a little more. And overall, Bangalore supports a lot of life. And for example, we have about 180 species, anywhere between 150 to 180 species, depending on which checklist we look at for butterflies in Bangalore. If you take the entire UK, I think they have less than 30 species of butterflies. So, you know, it's a very rich place for biodiversity, our city. And, you know, you can see a lot of these, if you come out on a nature walk, you'll be able to see a lot of these. And Bangalore has also been unique where, you know, people have planted a lot of, trees. Some of them are native trees like this flame of the forest, which is probably part of the original ecosystem in Bangalore. And then, you know, we've brought in trees from a lot of places around the world, and we've planted them as, you know, avenue trees. And these avenue trees give out beautiful flowers throughout the year and support a lot of life forms, from bees to butterflies to birds to bats, you name it. And, you know, these, they fill up our city today, and they support a lot of life. And they've been brought all the way from, South America, from Australia, from, you know, you name the place. Like this one comes from Guyana, and, this one comes from South America, and this one comes from Brazil again. So a lot of these trees have been put together as, avenue trees in Bangalore, and they support a lot of life as well. So we do have beautiful avenue trees, flowering trees in Bangalore. Some of the lesser plants like the touch me not, which can be commonly seen, also support a lot of butterflies and a lot of life. The giant milkweed is another plant which is very commonly found in Bangalore. and that supports a lot of life as well. Talking about the touch me not, let me go back. The leaf folds as soon as somebody comes near it. The reason being that, you know, it's a protective mechanism wherein the water within the leaves, they draw back to the small little bulb-like structure, and the leaf folds and pretends to be a thorn so that a browsing cattle does not consume it. And after the threat has passed, it slowly opens up again. So these are all adaptations that they have. The giant milkweed again has adaptations wherein it has a lot of chemicals that it has in its leaves. So a lot of butterflies which feed on this plant as the larval host plant, they tend to be bad tasting for their predators, which are birds. And the birds spit them out or vomit them out because they can't take them anymore. And there's a whole family of butterflies which feed on these and, you know, keep that toxins in their body to become bad tasting. The figs, again, like I said, banyan is a fig. We do have other figs as well. And some of these figs have fascinating stories. Like most figs, all figs, have this a unique adaptation called as a syconium, which is the fruit flower, you know, inflorescence, wherein it never opens up fully, but there's a small little hole. You can see that here. The small little hole is through which a wasp, we call it as a fig wasp, goes in. And, while going in, she tears up her wings. This is the female fig wasp. And she lays her eggs within the fig and dies within the fig. And the young ones, they come out. The males are blind. They're worm-like. They never see the sun. They're within the fruit all through. Whereas the females have wings. And then the males, they make a small hole, on the side of the fruit and allow the females to now go out intact with their wings. But before flying out, these female wasps collect a lot of pollen from the fruit and go visit another fruit. And while going inside, tear their wings, die. And in dying, they deposit the pollen. And it's so uniquely co-evolved that, you know, over millions of years, every single species of fig has one single species of, you know, wasp, which does this, you know, pollination. And if the wasp dies, the figs go extinct. If the figs die, the wasps go extinct. And their stories are very, very intertwined. And you can see these fig fruits all over the city, be it the peepal tree, the banyan tree, the weeping fig. You have a lot of fig trees around in Bangalore. Some lesser forms, these are bird nest mushrooms. The closest I've seen is in a garden right opposite Banashankari Temple. These are bird nest mushrooms. They are held in small cup-like structures with small egg-like structures which give out spores when water falls on them. And you can see beautiful, you know, variety of mushrooms around in the city, all around. And one of the other most common forms that we get within the houses is the silverfish. They are an insect life form which originally fed on wood and pulp of trees, but then now they have adapted to books because books are wood pulp, and so they feed on the paper of books. One of the only insects probably which don't have wings throughout any form of their life cycle. So they are, apart from the earwigs, I think this is one group of insects which don't have wings. And they're found commonly within our homes, and you can see them. Beetles are the most successful life forms on this planet. There are more beetles than most other species put together. Like, for example, I think the recorded number of beetle species around the world is close to 400,000 species. Close to 500,000 species, and people suspect that there is close to 1 million or more beetles left undiscovered even today, right, in terms of just the biodiversity. The beetles have a unique adaptation that no other insect has, which has given them this head start in terms of becoming the most diverse, the most prominent life forms on this planet. That is that, you know, the front pair of wings are modified into a hard structure, which is called as an elytra. And these two wings are held, these elytra are held up when the wings beat and the insect flies out. But then that covering, that hard covering, gives it enough protection to even survive stomping feet, or you know, sometimes even vehicles which drive over them. Today, people are looking at mass habitats built out of chitin, which is what the insect exoskeletons contain, and the beetle, elytra, are looked at as forms that can be adapted in Mars as nature-inspired design. But then beetles have pretty much occupied the entire planet, and they're found everywhere, and they're the most diverse of land animals that we have. We also have bugs. Bugs are again very common. The difference between beetles and bugs are soft-bodied. Bugs have sucking mouthparts, beetles have biting mouthparts, and you do find a lot of bugs around the city as well. Ants, some of the most common ants, these are the odor ants which we get in our kitchens. You crush them, they smell, they have white abdomens, very tiny little animals. These are the tapinoma or the odor ants. And then you also have the most common black ant which we get, which is the Camponotus, the carpenter ants, as we call them. Then you have the weaver ants. Weaver ants bring leaves of trees together and stitch them to form a nest, and they do have a nasty bite. Weaver ants are red in color and pretty long, like the black ant that is here, the Camponotus, the carpenter ant. And then we also get jumping ants. If you go out into woodlands, you get these ants called jumping ants. They can jump a significant distance. They're found again quite common in the outdoors in Bangalore. Ants are so numerous that if you take all ants in the world and put them on one side of the scale, and if you take all living vertebrates, that includes all humans, all sea animals, all land animals, and put them on the other side of this scale, the ants will outweigh them, outweigh all vertebrates put together. There are that many ants on this planet. And we can see, we do an ant walk. EcoEDU does an ant walk around Bangalore. We do it in Lal Bagh, in Kabban Park, and a few other places. Once in a while, we do have this open for public as well. And during our our ant walks, we see about close to about 20 species of ants in about 3 hours. And we cover a distance of about half a kilometer, maybe 500 meters. And we see about 20 species of ants very easily within that distance. So you do get ants everywhere, and they're very beautiful, fascinating creatures to look at. A very close relative of the ants is the wasp. And these are the potter wasps, which take mud from the soil, from the ground. They mix it with some moisture and make pots, small little pots. They catch hold of a caterpillar or a spider, inject them with their eggs, put them inside the pot and seal the pot. And when the eggs hatch, they have fresh meat. The animal is not dead yet. The caterpillar is just held in some sort of a coma. And the young ones of the wasp eat their way out of this spider or the caterpillar, and they come out of the pots. So these are potter wasps. We similarly have paper wasps, which build these big paper nests as well. And you can get a variety of them. Easiest places to spot these wasps are windows, where you can look at the window grills and you would see small little clay structures, which are the parts of these wasps around your homes. Or you can see a tubular brown color paper structure. Those are the paper wasps. So you can get to see both the paper and the potter wasps around your windows within the city. The praying mantis is again a voracious feeder of the insect world. They're one of the predators which eat a lot of insects. You can get them in every garden. If you have not sprayed your garden with chemicals, you would get them. They come in and they basically predate on other insects. So they're very good biocontrollers for other insects that prey upon plants in your garden. And they basically catch hold of an insect. The front pair of their legs is modified into pincers, and they tear them up and they eat them up. Again, they come in variety of life, species, variety of life forms, but the group itself is the praying mantis. The dragonflies, we did talk about the globe skimmer, but there are a bunch of dragonflies that we get in the city, a lot of species, and there are materials available on the internet. There are groups which can help you identify dragonflies on Facebook. Make sure that you join some of these groups, try to learn about dragonflies around. There are some very pretty ones like this one. There are also literally ones which are completely blue in color. So you get various types of dragonflies that one can see around in the city. A very close relative of the dragonfly is the damselfly. Damselflies also, they hold their wings closed, whereas dragonflies keep their wings open. They're also very pretty, very, very dainty creatures, and you get them in a variety of life forms again. Largely found outside or in the gardens, but you would get to see them in Bangalore, a whole lot of them. Butterflies and moths, we get a variety of them, like I said. Moths, like for example, some of these moths come all the way from China. They come migrating from China and go back. These are the hawk moths. This is the one of the hawk moths, which is the coffee bean hawk moth. But you do have the hummingbird bee hawk moth. You have multiple hawk moths which visit us. This is one of the butterflies which feeds on the milkweed, which I was talking about, and stores toxins in their body. Then you have the red pyro, which basically feeds on bryophyllum. So if you have a bryophyllum plant, in your garden, you would be able to see this butterfly around. You can't see the larva because the larva burrows between the two layers of the leaf, but you would still be able to see this butterfly around, one of the prettiest butterflies in the world. And we get a variety of these butterflies and moths in Bangalore. Spiders, we did talk about the tarantula, but you go to any tree in anywhere in Bangalore, any of the most of the gardens, and tap the tree, you'll be able to see disturb this spider, which is called as the common two tail. It's got two small little tails coming out of the abdomen, and it would scurry up the tree trunk, and you would be able to see this spider in most of the tree trunks in Bangalore, most of the gardens, and a very, very common life form. During October and September, you would also get to see this, which is the giant wood spider, come into the city. So you'd get them in gardens within the city, and then they would go back to the outskirts. But these are, they build webs which are like about 10 to 15 feet spans, and very strong webs. And, they can even snare small little birds as well. And you get a variety of other spiders, some which build webs, some which don't. Scorpions, again, very common in gardens, especially in the outskirts, you'd get to see a lot of them. They do have a venomous sting. The smaller scorpions have more potent venom versus the larger scorpions in scorpions, but you do get to see them around in the cities. Extremely good predators of smaller life forms. We also get centipedes and millipedes. Millipedes are basically saprophytes. They feed on dead and decaying leaf matter, and they burrow within the leaf matter. Whereas centipedes, they hunt. They have a venom gland and they hunt other insects actively. The difference between the centipedes and millipedes is for every segment in a centipede, it has two legs, one on each side, as you can see here. It's one leg per segment on each side. Whereas the millipede, for every segment, as you can see here, it has two legs on each side. So they have four legs per segment. Centipedes have two legs per segment. Very easy to distinguish. So make sure that, before you handle or pick up any of these insects, animals, make sure that, whether you're handling a centipede or a millipede. These are not insects. Insects have six legs. These have multiple legs, and they're called myriapods. Myriad means many, and poda means legs in Latin. So they have multiple legs. So they are called, with that name, both centipedes and millipedes. And you also get slugs and snails. Slugs, common garden slugs. These are snails without a shell. And you also get snails with shells. We do have an invasive snail, which is more common in Bangalore. It comes from Africa. It's called as the apple snail or the African garden snail, which is very big. They are a pest in our garden, but then you also get to see other snails and slugs, in gardens and outside within the city. We also get frogs and toads. All toads are frogs again. It's just that, they're called toads because they're found away from water, and they do have a little warty skin as compared to other frogs, which seem to have more moist and slippery skin. Frogs and toads, again, we do get about, we do a frog workshop sometimes, so an overnight workshop where during that workshop around a water body in Bangalore, we get around anywhere between 12 to 18 different types of frogs that are recorded within a night. So you do get around 15-16 frogs in Bangalore, and you can see them out. They used to be a lot more common within the city. Now they're not, thanks to the urbanization. Moving on to lizards, most of these lizards used to be found in my garden in Basungudi at one point in time, no longer. This is the common gecko, which we will see in houses. You do get to see them even today within houses. The garden lizard is rarer, but you will still get to see them in gardens outside. The skink used to be very common in gardens in Bangalore. Now they're very rare, and you can see them probably in gardens and outskirts. They're very common again. The rock agama, these are found on rocks and rock surfaces within the city. The closest place I've seen a rock agama today is in Banashankari, one of the hills in Banashankari within the city. So they all of them used to be found on rocks in Lal Bagh and other places. You do get to see skinks. The three of these in Lal Bagh, I have not seen a rock agama in Lal Bagh ever, but you do get to see them in other rocks in the city. Moving on to snakes, we have the rat snake, which is the most common snake. They eat a lot of rats. You can see, distinguish them with these black marks on their mouth. They also have a false hood, so they do try to elongate their heads and look like a cobra. But they're quite, they're non-venomous. They're extremely aggressive, though, non-venomous. And they catch and eat rats quite a lot. The other snake that you would see, very common in Lal Bagh, is the checkered keelback. If you go to Lal Bagh, you would see at least four or five of these snakes in the lake. These are snakes which lie about around the lakes, waiting for water bodies, waiting for fish. They are very good swimmers. Most snakes are very good swimmers, but these live in water, freshwater snakes. Again, non-venomous. You can get to see them in Lal Bagh quite easily. The big four, all four big venomous snakes are found in Bangalore. The common cobra, the Russell's viper, the salt-scaled viper, and the common crate, all four have been recorded within the city in Bangalore. I must have seen most of them in homes within the city in Bangalore, and kind of relocated them to somewhere else. But they are pretty much there, though we don't get to see them often. You should be, if one is lucky, you can still get to see them within homes, but then outside in the gardens, definitely yes, especially in Lal Bagh and other places. We get two types of crows, the jungle crow or the large-billed crow, which has become more common than the house crow. The house crows have a gray neck. The large-billed crows are all black. You do get to see both these birds within the city. Similarly, we get two types of mynas, more common mynas, the common myna and the jungle myna. You have these two, and the jungle myna has this tuft of feathers coming up near the base of its beak, whereas the common myna has a patch of yellow around the eye, and you get to see both of these in gardens today. We also get munias. These nest within our, this bird actually nests in my balcony. You do get munias around the city as well. This is the scaly-breasted munia, as it is called now. Earlier, it was called as the spotted munia. And this is the Indian silverbill, as it is called now. Earlier, it was called as the white-rumped munia. Both of them nest around in houses in Bangalore. Pigeons and doves, we obviously know the pigeon, the blue rock pigeon or the common pigeon. But we do get doves. We do get some of them. We have the spotted dove, as it is called, which has got a chessboard-like marking on the back of its neck. And this is called as the laughing dove, which makes a laughing call, a call which sounds like laughter. And that is this bird is found in the outskirts. It's a much more slender bird as compared to the spotted dove. But again, very common birds. Bulbuls, we get them again in our balcony. This is the red whiskered bulbul. It has a small tuft of feathers coming out like a whisker. That's why it's called as the red whiskered bulbul. Both of them have a red vent. This part of the bird is called as a vent. And hence this bird is called as the red vented bulbul because it doesn't have a whisker. This is found more on the outskirts today. While growing up, both used to be found within the city when I was a kid. But you do get to see them in Bangalore as quite common. The most commonly heard bird, which is the white-cheeked barbet, it keeps on giving out a call which says, you know, which goes like kudruk, kudruk. And, you know, that bird has a lot of, stories associated with it. But then this bird, both these birds feed on berries mainly. This is the coppersmith barbet. They use holes in trees to actually build nests. And these nests are then occupied by parakeets and by, you know, other birds like the mynas. We also have the cuckoos, the two most common ones, the Asian koel and the cowkill. Both these are found in inside the city. I see the cowkill right outside my door, and I also hear the koel quite often in the middle of the night, in fact. And some of the common birds that you get to see, water birds or waders as we call them, the long-legged birds. This is the cattle egret. Wherever there is cattle being taken out around the outskirts, you'd see these birds sitting on top of the cattle or around them. Some of the lakes like Lal Bagh and other places would have the pond heron, the gray heron, and the red wattled lapwing, as we call this bird. This bird goes on calling as, did you do it? Why did you do it? He did it. Why did he do it? You know, it can be paraphrased like that, the call of the bird itself. But these birds are, again, very commonly found. Some of the ducks, a lot of them are migratory. They come from all the way from Siberia and Central Asia. This is the northern pintail and, the gargany. You also get other birds which are residents, like the dabchick and the spot-billed duck. These are residents. They build their nest here. And, you can often see them with small little babies floating around in water. The crakes and the rails, you have the purple moorhen, or as it is called now, the gray-headed swamp hen, I think. And then the Indian moorhen. And you also have the coot. All of these are very common birds around the city. Anywhere if you go where there is water, you'll be able to see them. Some of the birds of prey, the most common, which we call as the eagle, it's actually the kite, the common kite, or the black kite as it is called, though it's a brown-colored bird. The easiest way to distinguish this is there's a notch in the tail, which looks like an inverted V. So one can see this bird flying around, sitting on top of buildings. Then you also have the bird, which is called as the Garuda or the Brahmini kite, which is more often found near water in Bangalore. And this bird has looks almost like a miniature bald eagle that we are familiar with as the American, you know, national bird. And this primarily feeds on fish. We also get the Fikra. The Fikra is a sparrowhawk or a close relative of the sparrowhawk. And it feeds mainly on smaller birds. And you can see the Shikra, also within the city, quite common. These are the three most common birds of prey we get within the city. Two of the most common owls we get are the spotted owlet, which sound like a monkey calling, a group of monkeys chattering when they call. And the very eerie sounding, screeching call of the barn owl. The barn owl can be seen even while you wait at traffic signals in the night on MG Road or wherever it is within the city. You'll see this white bird, flying overhead. That's the barn owl. Both of them eat a lot of rats. They predate on a whole lot of lesser life forms. The spotted owlet eats a whole lot of lesser life forms. And the barn owls eat a lot of rats and keep them in control. You can see both of them very common in the city. The sparrow, house sparrow, again, is something that used to be common in the city. Now it is found in pockets within the city. If you go to KR Market, Shivaji Nagar, Johnson Market, any of these older markets, you'd still get to see them pecking at grains. Older areas like Mavali, some parts of Indranagar also hold significant populations of these. The most common monkey, we get a troop of 20 of these in our house every day. in our apartment. So this is the bonnet macaque. They have a parting in the hair, which looks like them wearing a cap, so or a bonnet. So they're called as the bonnet macaque. And they are very common, you know, monkeys that we get here. Used to be very common. Now a lot of these troops have been translocated, relocated to other places outside the city because they were creating a lot of havoc. But you do still get to see them around temples. Bats, we did speak about bats, the flying fox. And these are the short-nosed fruit bats. Bats probably plant more trees than most other animals, put together, because they eat a lot of fruit. And whenever they poop these fruit out, they grow into trees. And you have bats literally planting gardens around the city, right? And bats, birds, both of them eat a lot of fruit and defecate a lot of seeds. And they are primarily responsible for a lot of vegetative growth in the city. And we should be thankful if the city is green in a large part to bats, which plant trees and other plants. Another group which plants a lot of trees and plants where they bury seeds and forget where they're buried are the squirrels and the rodents. And we get the bandicoot, the common Indian rat, and we also have the tree-striped palm squirrel, which is very common within the city. All of these are rodents, and they're very, very common in the city. You can see them all through. The spotted deer, again, can be found as close as Banashankari in Bangalore, near Turahalli. There's a medical college. You can see a population of them. In fact, 2 months ago, there was one spotted deer rescued from a restaurant, a roadside eatery in Banashankari 6th stage, I think, in Bangalore. You do get to see them quite often. The gar, again, we spoke about the gar. This is the largest bovine in the world. This can again be seen around in Banagatta. The gray mongoose is again another animal that can be seen often, more on the outskirts, but also in gardens. They prey on smaller animals, and they eat a lot of different types of insects and animals, and you can see them if you're lucky, during the evenings around, gardens. Some cities have them more common, like Chennai. In fact, if you go to IIT Chennai campus, you'll see them raiding trash cans. Same with IIT Mumbai as well. So you get to see quite a lot of them in other cities. The Indian jackal, the closest I've seen is what is today the Hoskerehalli locality. But you do get to see them on the outskirts, no longer found within the city. I'm talking about a few decades ago. I've seen them around that area, but they are still present around. The leopards are very much present within the city. In fact, we've had them come to schools as well, a few years ago. But then you do get to see leopards around Turahalli Valley School. All these areas have leopards, which come and visit them quite regularly. One of the favorite foods of the leopards are the stray dogs. So they do get to lift quite a lot of stray dogs and feed on them. We did speak about the tiger being recorded now. So having seen all these animals and life forms, what can you do as a citizen? You can go out, touch, feel trees, get closer to nature, go outdoors, or within your gardens during this pandemic, at least go outdoors and or within your terraces and see life, other life forms, and see what else is there on those spots, in those spots, on those plants. Is there a caterpillar? Is there anything? Come out on nature walks once we are through with these difficult times. You can join us for nature walks. There are nature walks happening every weekend within the city. You can join any of these nature walks, and you can get to learn more about life around you. Go camping, because you get the best teacher. The best way to experience outdoors is to spend a night outdoors in the wilderness, and there's nothing that beats camping. Go out camping, and you'll be able to see again a whole lot of life forms. Go out on expeditions. This was when we went out to see the Amur falcons in Nagaland. We can go out and actually, specifically to see a certain group of animals, go out and see those before they disappear. great way to spend holidays. If you're locked in at home, you could look at movies. Great place to start as David Attenborough's movies. You can look at all the Life series, The Blue Planet, The Planet Earth 2. All these are available today on streaming, on various streaming platforms. So all you need is an internet connection to look at them today, and they're there, right? And you could take a look at them. Get started with books. There are a bunch of books that one can start, especially children. One of the best books I would recommend is of Birds and Bird Song by M. Krishnan, a great collection of writing on Indian wildlife, on birds, basically, and whatever he wrote in the Hindu and which appeared have been collected together and made into a book. Jim Corbett, of course, and Kenneth Anderson, who's called as the Jim Corbett of South India, are great places to start. Very romantic books to read. Pick up fictional books also, like The Jungle Book, or some more things that teach you about the outdoors, like The Amateur Naturalist by Gerald Durrell. I think it's one of the best books you could pick up to learn about, wildlife around you. You can pick up apps. There's a whole lot of apps on my phone as well. So you can, most of these apps are free. You can load them on your phones and you can look at it. If you don't know any identity of anything which you're seeing, you can just click that picture, put it on your phone and put it on iNaturalist, and somebody would be able to help you with the identity of that. If you need a plant ID, you can just take your camera, point it at that plant, and if you have plant net, it will be able to identify what that plant is most often than not. You could also look at Google playbooks where there are, bird books available, eBird India, where you could record your sightings, Vanya, which is a great bird, guide app. You can look at Story of Life again, which is Sir David Attenborough's things. Frog Find is a free app to identify frogs around your homes. Great apps again that one can have. You could also get into art. These are artworks by some of the more prominent wildlife artists. This is by Sangeeta Kadur. This is by Abhishekha. Beautiful drawings. And these are by my kids when they were a lot younger. This is when they were 6 and 5. But you could get them started early. They could start sketching. They could start looking at life forms and drawing out things and recording what they are seeing. And great way to get started, because when you start to draw, you tend to observe more some of the minute details which otherwise you would not. You could also capture through photography. You could go with big lenses or with even cameras. You could record them, record the sounds of birds. All these are things that one could do. You could also plant trees. If going out and planting trees is difficult, you could look at trees, existing trees around your residence, and try and name them at least as to what they are, and so that it helps other people. You could have boards put up like this, which doesn't harm the tree in any way. You could also plant gardens, terrace gardens. This is a terrace garden of a friend in JP Nagar, another wildlife enthusiast, and he's taken empty paint cans and grown plants, and he is visited by a huge number of life forms, including peacocks, which come and sit on top of his house in JP Nagar. So you could do all these things. You could even take butterfly larvae. My kids keep doing this once in a while. Put them in a bottle, put some leaves of the tree or the plant where they were found, observe the entire life cycle, record it, from the larva to an imago butterfly emerging out of, a chrysalis. And you can look at this and, you could record this entire journey of the butterfly itself. And it's a beautiful thing to observe this transformation or complete metamorphosis, as we call it. You could also look at migration. Butterflies were migrating last month in Bangalore, and there's a WhatsApp group for butterfly migration. You could record your sightings there. Throughout the city, common people were looking out from their balconies, from their terraces, and recording these migrations and posting it on the WhatsApp group. So you could do that as well. Bird baths. Shubha Bhatt at IAC has built some of the best bird baths, and she's perfected the technique wherein even birds come and take a shower now in her garden. all it needs is a saucer-like plate, a large plate, which is saucer-like, and you keep a small rock in the middle and fill it a little bit with water, and you would these are bird magnets. Literally during summer, you would see tons of birds come and use them, and you'd get to see birds close at hand. Bird feeders don't work very well in our region because we are a tropical region. So there's a lot of food available, but water is scarce. So bird baths work best, but you can try out bird feeders as well. This is a friend who keeps a record of birds he sees in Baswangudi. So this is a regular attendance register from a stationery shop, and he's recorded each bird and put a present or an absent. And he has built this data over a few years now. And once tabulated, they provide a very accurate description and in terms of distribution around his house of most common birds. One could do that. You could join us for censuses and surveys when we go out. You could join us for group bird watching. There are four nature walks that happen, four group bird watchings that happen around the city. Lal Bagh is always on the second Sunday. Hebbal is on the first Sunday. The third and the fourth Sunday is posted on this website called BNG Birds. But now we've paused it because of the pandemic, but we will start again soon once people start going out. And you can study rocks. You can also study ants, like I said. You know, these are all good things to do around your homes, and they can be seen. And these are all the wild regions around Bangalore, including lakes. You have Lal Bagh, Kabban Park. You have Vanagatta here. You've got the Sankey Tank. Also, you know, all these places you can go out and see life. Some of the links of places where you could do what you want to do. So we have a Telegram group. You can join the Telegram group at any point in time. We have a you know, bunch of Facebook groups which you could go and look at for various life forms as well. Finally, thanks to all the people who've given their photographs for use on this presentation. Some of the material that one can use, learning material, go to earlybird.in. You get flashcards, small little pocket guides. You get bird bingo, tree bingo, a whole lot of material they're putting out. One can pick it up from NCF or from Early Bird. Some of the books that we bring out as EcoEdu, you can pick them up also on our website. So thank you so much. Now I would welcome if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you so much, Ullas. That was absolutely fascinating. And you know, it's amazing how much we learn about our biodiversity each time, you know, where, you know, somebody like you makes a presentation. So thank you for that. We'd now like to invite children who might have questions. You can raise your hand and we will bring you on screen and you can ask your questions to Ullas. So adults can Google search their queries, but we want children, you know, if there are any attending. So there's raise hand screen at the bottom of your screen. If you raise your hand, we'll bring you online and you can ask your questions. Okay, so in the meanwhile that people think about their questions and raise their hands, we have two questions which I will ask Ullas myself. The first is by Rupam. What is your take on, as in this is an adult question, but you know, it can be super brief. The first question is by Rupam, and you know, what is your sort of take on the policies related to urban wildlife? And the second question by Sriram is on what is the lifespan of a skimmer and how long does the journey take to and from Africa?
Okay, so to answer the first question, unfortunately, you know, a lot of the policies around wildlife are in protected areas. We don't have many policies around wildlife in urban areas, though most of the animals are protected by what we call as the wildlife protect the schedules. Either the animals fall in a schedule, you know, one of the schedules of the Wildlife Protection Act. So individual animals are protected by law, but enforcement is difficult. Urban green areas are not protected. Urban green areas tend to give way to development very easily, because they are not protected by law. But you know, most of the land use laws are for wildlife and protected areas in the country, and not for urban areas. Unfortunately, that's the reality today. We do have land use in terms of spaces reserved for gardens, but unfortunately, most of the gardens have plants which are given out to a landscapist, which don't support any wildlife or any life forms today, because they are literally, completely, alien to this landscape, and they don't support.
And the BBMP parks, not to forget.
Yeah, yeah. Those, in fact, most of those plants that they plant there are literally, sterile when it comes to supporting wildlife, right? So there needs to be more eco-friendly gardening, which needs to come into landscaping. And we do talk to landscapers quite often, and hopefully there would be changes that they would bring in terms of what they bring into gardens. So that's what we have. And to answer the second question on the globe skimmer, dragonfly, so there is there was a study which was done by some American researchers which pointed out that the third or the fourth generation which makes the journey back, the wing shape of those dragonflies also change for the journey, meaning that generation of the dragonfly, the wing shape itself is different. And most of the dragonflies, the lifespan would be, adult lifespan would be probably 15 days to a month. Of these creatures, whereas their entire life cycle starts in the water, and then they again undergo a metamorphosis, and they come out, and then you see what the dragonflies that you see, which are familiar to you. But then the journey between India and Africa probably takes a few days, 1 or 2 days, maybe a little longer, but they fly straight out across the sea. So and they are aided by the winds. So, which is what makes the journey, easier for them. And the Amu falcons, which migrate all the way from the Amu region in China and go again to Ethiopia, crossing across India, they again do the same journey across the seas. And Amu falcons are insectivorous falcons. So, the belief is that they are following these dragonflies or feeding on these dragonflies when these dragonflies are migrating in their thousands and millions. So the Amur falcons in their hundreds of thousands feed on these during that journey. Just to give you an example, the Nagaland expedition, which I showed you pictures of, the Amur falcons that we saw in one single place, in one single day, there were about 150,000 falcons, right? So that's the volume, that's the number of falcons that migrate. It's a very fascinating journey. So probably their lifespan is around a month. There are some butterflies though, which live probably 6 months. But most insects, I think, the adult part of their lives are restricted to only breeding and mating and procreation.
Thank you. That's, again, as fascinating as rest of, all the journeys of the ants, insects, and all the other creatures. We have time for one last question. We have Sharanya Nagraj, who has a question. Sharanya, can you unmute? And ask your question. Yeah.
Does Bangalore have, is Bangalore high?
Sorry, Sharanya, can you say that again?
Does Bangalore's biodiversity have a high amount of gene diversity and species diversity?
Gene diversity and what? What are the diversity?
Species.
Species. Yeah, species diversity, like I said, I showed a slide which did point to the kind of species that we have as biodiversity. Species diversity, gene diversity also would be very strong, because we do have, Bangalore is a very small region to study gene diversity, but then we would get certain races and certain species, like for example, the paradise flycatchers, the Asian paradise flycatchers. I think there is a strong amount of, gene diversity within that species. Similarly, we do get different forms of, other species of, warblers and things like that, where I think, we do get a strong representation as well. So there is certainly a lot of gene and biodiversity, both in terms of species and genes, which can be seen in Bangalore. And there's a whole lot of them. You do get different races of birds. You do get different forms of them. within the same species, you also get to see a lot of species as well, especially birds and butterflies and mammals.
I'm afraid we've run out of time. Thank you so much, Ulas. That was absolutely fantastic. And this video is going to be available on YouTube for those of you who'd like to share it with your friends or watch it again. And thank you everyone for joining us on this Saturday morning.
Thanks for having me, Raghu. It was a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.